I feel like the world is so messed up, and yet there's so much beauty in it. And it's, what do we pay attention to? What do we tap into? Who do we connect with? What do they bring out of us?
Very first thing you see him do is attempt to break free of his own atmosphere and just fall into oblivion trying.
Yeah.
And that's essentially what he does throughout the entire film. And like, he sees this is a man that's also been doing that. Despite everything that he knows John Silver's already done, he recognizes this is a man who understands life the same way I do.
Some people aren't super keen on relationships, but I think most people on some level, that's the thing that's most important. That connection is what makes us human.
Welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Alan Seawright, a professional filmmaker who needs therapy. I'm joined by my co-host,
Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies, and I'm so happy that we have this guest with us today.
Who are you?
I am David Sant, a highly unprofessional filmmaker who has intimate knowledge of what Jono's hairbrush smells like.
What did he say?
Oh my gosh.
Not true.
David is one of our post-producers and editors, and your style is to make us look absolutely insane.
I try my hardest.
Responsible for
David
what?
David is the geese.
I am the geese.
Bird.
Get out! Run!
This isn't
that smile. This is a nightmare.
But we love your energy, and we love your sense of humor, and we've just been saying for a long time we want to have you on the show.
And we finally got him, folks!
Yeah.
And here we are.
And we're going to talk about
one of my favorite movies, Treasure Planet.
Jonathan, you're going to be reacting,
and
we're just going to be loving.
Due to a violation of his probation.
Yes, yes. No, I understand. But could we just...
Pardon me. Officers, if I might interject.
Yes, Niles.
I am the noted astrophysicist, Dr. Delbert Doppler. Perhaps you've heard of me. No?
No?
Are you the boy's father?
Oh,
what? No.
Good heavens, no.
Ew, he's just an old friend of the family.
Back off, sir.
Thank you, Delbert. I will take it from here.
Well, Sarah, if you insist, don't ever let me do that again.
Due to repeated violations of Statute 15C, we have impounded his vehicle. Any more slip-ups will result in a one-way ticket to juvenile hall. Kitty Hushka, the slammo.
Thank you, officers. It won't happen again.
We see his type all the time, ma'am. Wrong choices, said Enders. Losers.
It's basically the beginning of J.J. Abrams' Star Trek, right? It's
pretty
the same exact same thing.
James Tiberius Hawkins.
Jim, I have had it. Do you want to go to juvenile hall? Is that it? Jim, look at me.
Unironically, I super have a crush on Sarah Hawkins, by the way.
Without you,
Mom, it's no big deal. There was nobody around. Those cops just won't get off my...
How do you reach a kid like that? Not interested in what you have to say, completely just sort of checked out.
The very first thing is you need to take interest in what they're interested in.
Sure.
And even if you're not interested in that, you care about them. Like, my mom got really into Jackie Chan when I was in high school because that mattered to me. I think you're super into Fortnite, even though you hate Fortnite.
It's Minecraft.
Is it Minecraft?
I know a shocking amount about the Ender Dragon.
To me, it really comes down to you gain that trust on the little things by showing interest in the little things, and then when it comes to the big things, they're more likely to open up,
for sure.
Right? And I'm not saying she hasn't done that, but in their case, you know, she's lost her husband, he's lost his father, and he's just kind of sick of the world and sick of life and seeking a thrill and doesn't really care what happens to him because what's the point?
Yeah.
And the fact is, you can't control people, especially as a parent. All you can do is give guidance and give choices with consequences, but you have to honor their free will, otherwise you're going to get rebellion time and time again.
I didn't pull any of these clips for us to watch, but I just want to talk about, this is one of the greatest movies I've ever seen that's just like pure adventure filmmaking.
Mm.
Like, it just feels like adventure. The scene where they're casting off lines and about to sail away, like between James Newton Howard's music and the shot design and selection of the sails coming out and Jim just being in awe of this thing that he's always wanted to do and never been able to do. It feels like being young and setting out on a journey that's like scary, but exciting and fun. And you don't know what's going to happen. And it's just like, this is sort of my gold standard of adventure filmmaking. If I ever get to make a movie like this,
mm-hmm.
I am going to study this movie stem to stern, top to tail. And just like, I want to make movies like this. It's so much fun.
commission a ship, hire a captain and a crew.
You're not serious.
Oh, my life.
Why is his toothbrush up on top of a pile of books?
Go, Delbert. Go, Delbert.
Okay, okay, you're both grounded.
Mom, look. I know that I keep messing everything up. And I know that I let you down. But this is my chance to make it up to you. I'm gonna set things right.
Sarah, if I may. You said yourself, you've tried everything. There are much worse remedies than a few character-building months in space.
Are you saying this because it's the right thing, or because you really want to go?
I really, 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 really want to go. And it's the right thing.
Jim, I don't want to lose you.
Mom, you won't. I'll make you proud.
Well, there we are then. We'll begin preparations at once. Jim, my boy, soon we'll be off to the spaceport.
Animation question.
Sure.
Why animate someone Jim's age with bags under his eyes?
Well, that's a performance question, not an animation question.
What do you mean?
How do you show that he's tired and world weary?
Exactly. And so someone his age who looks like that has been through a lot.
Yes.
I think that's what they're going for.
You'll see that they disappear later on.
Do they?
I believe so.
Actually, there's a lot of stuff that changes about Jim's appearance as you go throughout the film. Like in the first scene of the movie, he's wearing all black.
Mm.
And then the clothes that he wears slowly shift. He loses his dark jacket. And at the end of the film, he's wearing a completely white uniform and no bags under his eyes. He looks younger, happier. Like the amount of detail in this animation is insane.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, Jim doesn't respond very well to Delbert. Like he likes him okay, but he doesn't see him as a father figure.
No.
He connects with John. With John Silver as, okay, this is somebody who can help me chart the course I want through my life. And it's probably because Jim wants to be in space.
He wants to be a spacer. He wants to be kind of a rough and tumble adventurous guy. And that's who John Silver is.
It's a key part of Jim's character to me that he doesn't respond to Delbert. Because, like, you can see right in the very first time you see teenage Jim in the film, he's solar surfing through that industrial park, shoots up into the sky, and then just goes into a free fall.
Yeah.
And I know that's, like, probably mostly just meant to look cool.
It's mostly it's like, because everything had to be extreme in the late 90s and early aughts.
Delbert is kind of like the personification of like what it is to be at home. You know, he's like awkward, he's funny, always in a bathrobe and slippers.
Yeah, and he's smart and he's sweet and he's nurturing just like Jim's mom, and Jim misses his dad. Like he's already got, that's like, Delbert is just like an extra serving of mom.
Right, yeah, and you know, adult Jim's very first thing you see him do is attempt to break free of his own atmosphere and just fall into oblivion trying.
Yeah.
And that's essentially what he does throughout the entire film. And like he sees this is a man that's also been doing that. Despite everything that he knows John Silver's already done, he recognizes this is a man who understands life the same way I do.
Yeah.
It wasn't your fault, you know.
Lost a sailor.
Why, half the crew would be spinning in that black abyss if not for...
Look, don't you get it? I screwed up. I mean, for 2 seconds, I thought that maybe I could do something right, but... I just...
Now, you listen to me, James Hawkins. You got the makings of greatness in you, but you gotta take the helm and charge your own course. Stick to it, no matter the squalls. And when the time comes, you get the chance to really test the cut of your sails and show what you're made of. Well, I hope I'm there, catching some of the light coming off you that day.
Right there on the gut.
It's comfy.
This dad bod personified. I wonder if he sees him as a father figure.
Right, Jimbo.
So. Nothing like crying into a beer belly, you know what I mean? It's soothing. It jiggles as you shudder.
Getting hugged by a robot arm.
I'm forgetting about my watch. And you'd best be getting some shut eye.
One of my favorite movie tropes is the villain or the anti-hero with a long suppressed conscience.
Yep.
And sense of humanity that, like, the cruelty of the world they live in has driven it out of them. And then there's somebody who comes into their life and reminds them of that. That's why 310 to Yuma is one of my favorite movies, because Russell Crowe is constantly trying to keep that at bay, you know, because that heart of gold that's way, way, way down deep in there. And I see with John Silver, he's reminded of a more innocent time for him, or maybe a time that he never had.
Yeah.
But he's been surrounded by rough and tumble, killer be killed, dog eat dog for so long that it's almost extinguished, you know, but it's somewhere in there. And so to me, it's a beautiful story of rediscovering that, because I feel like the world is so messed up and yet there's so much beauty in it. And it's, what do we pay attention to? What do we tap into? Who do we connect with? What do they bring out of us? Because if you connect with giant spider people, you're probably not going to be a great person.
Accurate.
That dude is creepy as hell.
I hate him.
Such a great character design, though.
Oh, yeah.
All of the aliens in this are so much fun, and also very clearly the inspiration for most of Rick and Morty.
Yep. Scroop is one of the most disgusting. I think it was probably the first time as a kid that I saw, like, a likable hero character actually die in a film.
Yeah.
And it was just this, like, awful spider lobster man, you know, yeah, like, sucking my favorite character into a black hole. And I was like, no! But, I mean, it's really good villain character building.
I say we kill them all now.
I love his little hair tendrils.
Yeah.
So cute.
Don't you pull with Mr. Arrow? And so help me, you'll be joining him! Strong talk. But I know otherwise.
You got something to say, Scroop?
It's that boy. Methinks you have a soft spot for him.
Now, mark me, the lot of you. I care about one thing and one thing only. Flint's throne. You think I'd risk it all for the sake of some nose-wiping little whelp?
What was it now? Oh, you got the makings of greatness. Yeah.
Shut your gap! I cozied up to that kid to keep him off our scent. But I ain't gone soft.
So what we see in this scene, and we see it in a ton of movies, is somebody damaging a personal relationship. John Silver, you know, obviously really hurting Jim Hawkins to maintain what status or like his standing, his hardened, rough and tough crew.
And their new friend always hears about it. I think of Shanghai Noon when Jackie Chan overhears Owen Wilson saying some racist crap.
I mean, it's practically a trope at this point.
Yeah.
Do you see this? Do you find this in therapy very often, where people are damaging a personal relationship to maintain?
Yeah. I know I say this a lot. I'm reading this book, but I am. It's called Real Love and Post-Childhood Stress Disorder, but it talks about the idea of we seek imitation love. Imitation love, the reason it's not real love, in order for it to be real, people have to see the real you and accept the real you.
Sure.
But we're afraid the people won't want the real us. And so, So we put up a front, right? Whatever we need to say or do to be accepted. And what we see a lot in movies, for example, John actually does love Jim, right? Sure. Ironically, he's saying to the other pirates here, I was keeping up appearances to throw him off our scent, but that's actually what he's doing with the pirates, right? I'm putting on this appearance of being this rough guy and tough guy who doesn't care so that you guys won't know that I actually do. And yeah, in relationships, people do this all the time. Why? Because we're afraid of rejection. We're afraid of being alone, or we're afraid of like a business or a career going south. Like, there's all sorts of priorities or goals that we put before the people that we care about the most. And then we're not real. And in order to actually have love and connection in our lives, we have to show who we really are, which is one of the things, candidly, that I appreciate most about you.
Thank you.
You are you are David in every context. And you are honest and true to yourself in every context. And I get a lot of comments and compliments from the Ace and Arrow community saying, Jono, thank you so much for seeing us and speaking about us and mentioning us. And it's really because of you. Like, because of you, I understand that better. And I'm like, I want to make sure that the Davids of the world get some love and are seen and are validated.
Real talk, that was actually like a huge part of my personal mental health journey.
Yeah.
Is for many, many years in high school. So I am asexual, but also biromantic. And so that caused a ton of confusion for me when I was younger, obviously.
Sure, yeah, understandably.
Yeah. And so for a lot of years, I was definitely in the closet about that. And so through a lot of the time that I was in high school, I was a theater kid, I was a choir kid, I was a band kid, did all the all the weird, nerdy, glee club kind of kid stuff. And as a result, I made friends with a ton of queer people. They ended up being a lot of my best friends. But then as a result of me being in the closet and kind of denial about a lot of who I was.
Yeah.
And also the fact that, you know, I was a deeply religious person. And in my head, my perception of my religion was that those two things have to be completely separate, you know? And so
there's no room for them to coexist.
Yeah, there is no room for crossover or coexistence. And so there was a period of time where I actually did start to really distance myself from a lot of my queer friends. And I've never been able to rescue some of those relationships to this day. Mm. And I just realized, like, I am making myself miserable by being someone other than what I am.
Right.
And it is a key part of your journey to just, you have to be you loudly wherever you are. And, like, your choices are yours and you can navigate that space however you want to. But that is something you're going to have to confront eventually.
I like to say a lot on the show that we need to make room at the table for everybody.
Yeah,
but sometimes making room at the table means demanding your spot and saying, I'm sitting here,
yes,
you know,
exactly,
which is awesome.
Move over.
Arfie, I wondered where you lit off to.
They're under siege now by him.
His poor old leg's downright snarky since that gave attack we had in the galley.
Stabbed him in the leg.
Whatever you heard back there, at least the part concerning you, I didn't mean a word of it. That bloodthirsty lot had thought I'd gone soft. They'd have gutted us both. Now listen to me. If we play our cards right, we can both walk away from this rich as kings.
Yeah?
You get me that map and an even portion of the treasure is yours.
Boy, you are really something. All that talk of greatness, light coming off my sails. What a joke.
See here, Jim.
I mean, at least you taught me one thing. Stick to it, right? Well, that's just what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna make sure that you never see one drabloon of my treasure.
That treasure is owed me, by thunder!
I'll try to find it without my map, by thunder!
Oh, you still don't know how to pick your fights, do you, boy? Now, mark me. Either I get that map by dawn tomorrow, or so help me, I'll use the ship's cannons to blast you all to kingdom come!
Here's the thing about lies. People don't believe you. I'm a genius! You heard it here first. When you tell lies, people don't believe you.
Huh?
That's wild.
Well, no, what I enjoy as an audience member watching this, though, is you're kind of questioning how much of this is true and how much of this is going to be a betrayal.
Who's he lying to? Or is he lying to everyone? Or
including himself.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, that's part of what makes this such a timeless story. Have any of you read Treasure Island, the original? Yeah, it's fantastic.
Someday.
But the fact is, like, we get used to dealing in half-truths. Mm-hmm. And half-truths are even more dangerous than, like, full-out lies because the liar can believe that a half-truth is a whole truth. Like, you can convince yourself of it.
Yeah.
And he's convincing himself, I'm not going to betray Jim. But he might, you know.
Probably will.
Probably will.
As soon as he gets his eyes on that treasure.
Can you pirate more, please?
I'd love to.
He gives it so much humanity and realism because it could easily just be a caricature.
Yeah, for sure.
Yes! More We are so out of here!
Ah, Jimbo!
And you're the seventh wonder of the universe.
Get back!
I like you, lad. But I've come too far to let you stand between me and my treasure.
Oh, he was gonna betray him the whole time.
I thought the voice work in this scene was just perfect.
Yeah.
Jimbo!
Reach!
Go, go, gadget!
Reach! I can't!
Dark version where he lets go a second later, Jim dies and he doesn't get the treasure. Well, okay, psychologically it all comes down to priorities, right? And relationships for not, I mean, we all value different things. True. And some people aren't super keen on relationships, but I think most people on some level, that's the thing that's most important, right? Is our connections, and they take different forms, sexual, romantic, friends, family, whatever. But that connection is what makes us human.
Yeah.
And I love that John here is finally yielding to that inner conscience, right? Yielding to that thing he's been trying to suppress for so long. And even though you can see it, as great as this film is, you can see it coming from a mile away, what he's going to do. Because there's no way the movie's going to end with Jim falling
to his... And he's dead. And oh, John Silver got the money. Okay, yeah. Well.
Can you imagine,
I guess it pays to be a pirate.
What if that was the movie?
Please.
Disney's like, yeah, we focus group this. And... Turns out the kids loved it. Just because we know where it's going doesn't mean it's not true and doesn't mean it's not powerful to watch.
That's what I'm gonna do.
And what do you see off that bow of yours?
A future.
Look at you. Glowing like a solar fire. You're something special, Jim. You're going to rattle the stars, you are.
Jim found a father.
A sentiment.
John found his soul.
Got a bit of grease in this cyborg eye of mine.
So Jim finds what he always needed, in my mind. Like, he wanted a life of adventure. But it was out of balance. Like, he thought the life of adventure had to come at the cost of pushing his mother away and pushing Delbert away and just striking out on his own. And he sees, like, no, I can do both, right? And the people I love will support me in that. And that's beautiful. And that's balanced. And I think far too often we overcorrect and we're hurting over here. And now we're hurting over here. It just looks different, right? And we got to find that center.
Yep.
That gooey dad bod center.
That gooey, gooey, weird dad bod, dog thing. What is he?
I don't know. I want to know. We can just let it stay magical.
Squishy. What he is. I love that this scene is so, like, it starts dark, and then as soon as he opens the hatch door, like, he makes a turn, and... it's all reflected in the lighting in the scene. Everything gets brighter. It gets warmer. It gets, nicer. And then the score, of course, it's James Newton Howard. He's good at it.
Yeah.
It's subtle and small, and it's not playing big things, but it's just there nudging you along.
Yeah.
Saying, oh, I feel good about this. Oh, I love.
It's warm.
Here's some flutes.
It's warm. And his voice acting is so warm. Like, it's just... Yeah. Yeah, what a beautiful film. Thanks, David.
Oh, yeah.
You're welcome.
You're welcome. I really, when I watched this scene to prep for this episode, I actually kind of had to like take a break because I was crying. I had to step back a little bit. And I finally realized, like, watching this as an adult, it hits so, so differently, because I wasn't really like this until probably high school or college, but I've very much been like a chart my own course kind of person, for better or for worse. And in some ways, it's really, really made my life better. In some ways, it's really, really made my life very, very difficult. I just, the moment when John Silver says, "You're gonna rattle the stars," and just it cuts back to Jim, and you just see those tears well up in his eyes. Yeah. And it's like, what that wouldn't have done for me if just someone, when it was I was at my very lowest, had told me, like, "You are going to shake the world," even when they had no reason to believe that.
Yeah.
Like, I would have done it. You know what I mean? Yeah. And yeah, I think about that, like, just like a quick example, like, I was working on some music with a friend about a year ago, and we were in the middle of working on, we were in the middle of working on, one of my songs, and he just kind of looked at me in the middle of the mixing session. And he said, "You know, David, when I work on your music, I feel like an artist."
Wow.
And I was like, "Shut up." I was like, "Don't do that. Not right now.
I am not equipped to deal with this."
Yes, exactly.
But it's like, praise. Ugh.
But it's like every time I work on my music now, every single time since then, that's what I've thought. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And oh my gosh. Yeah. It's just like, just if you see someone in your life that's struggling, like, really take the time to figure out, not even like what do they need to hear, just something you know they haven't heard before. Something that, just give someone a deep, honest, genuine, sincere compliment.
Yeah.
In a totally original way. And you literally could change their life around.
Yeah. Well, thank you for that.
Yeah.
I'm so glad we had you on the show.
It's been fun.
Yeah. Everything I hoped it would be and so much more.
There were cuddles.
So many.
There was weird sexual energy.
Yeah. Yeah. Basically, when the cameras are off, it's the same thing.
Pretty much.
Okay.
Delbert, would you please explain how ridiculous this is?
It's totally preposterous, traversing the entire galaxy alone.
Now, at last, we hear some sense.
That's why I'm going with you.
Delbert!
I'll use my savings to finance an expedition. I'll commission a ship, hire a captain and a crew.
You're not serious.
All my life I've been waiting for an opportunity like this, and here it is, screaming! Go, Delbert! Go, Delbert! Go!
Okay, you're both grounded!